The ACAC is proud to bring together the special guest panelists for today's virtual panel discussion honoring the 1961 U.S. World Team on the 60th anniversary. While we cannot be together in person just yet, we are grateful to have this opportunity to gather virtually and appreciate all of you for joining us today. Please welcome our host, former national and international senior pairs competitor and club coach, Jimmy Morgan.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to tonight's panel discussion. I'm so excited. We have such a great lineup of guests and panelists, as well as Team USA current Team USA skaters. I'll be joined by these panelists. We're going to reflect back on 1961, those that were tragically lost, and as well as their legacy that lives on through the current U.S. Figure Skating Memorial Fund. Without further ado, I'd love to get introducing to today's panelists. We're going to start with the Legends panel, and we will have open discussion from there. First off, I would love to start off with Dr. Tenley Albright. She is the 1956 Olympic champion, the two-time world champion, and fun fact, she's actually joining us live today from the Skating Club of Boston Trophy Room, which houses memorabilia from the past 100 years. So excited to have her. Thank you for joining us, Tenley. We also have Frank Carroll, a world-renowned Olympic coach. He was also a student of Maribel Vinson Owen. We also are joined by Barbara Rolls-Williams, 1960 Olympic bronze medalist. She's the 1962 U.S. champion alongside the U.S. Figure Skating Hall of Fame inductee and PSA Hall of Fame inductee. We are joined by Tina Noyes, 1964, 1968 Olympic team member. Thank you so much for joining us. Paul George, the 1962 U.S. Junior Pairs Champion, 1980 Olympic team leader, the president of the U.S. Figure Skating Foundation, which manages the Memorial Fund. And he was also coached by Maribel Vinson Owen. We are so lucky to be joined by Dr. Lorraine Hanlon, Commanor, 1962, 1963 world competitor, 1963 US champion. And thank you so much for joining us, Christy Allen Piper and Rana Gladstone, who are current staff coaches at the Skating Club of Boston, and two coaches that I look up to very fondly. So thank you so much for joining us. I would love to start off with a open discussion. The events of 1961 might be a moment of sadness for a lot of people, but I think we can also draw a lot of inspiration from the lives that were lost. Does anyone have any sort of inspiration that they like to draw from the 1961 world team?
Well, this is Tenley, and I have to say, terrific that our wonderful world team in 1961 has brought us together today. And that's inspiring. And they are inspiring and still inspiring us. And how something so tragic and horrendous, and devastating, we can talk about the inspiring, but it really is. And when I look at the picture of our team and see how happy and how energetic and how really vivacious they are and anticipating getting to the world championships that they've trained for, and they're all at the peak performance. But it is inspiring to think that we can get together and talk about it, because we never get over the tragedy that happened, but there are some inspiring things about it. And of course the Memorial Fund is one of the very most inspiring things. The fact that skaters now can be inspired to do their best. And, we don't often all get a chance to talk about the team and the individuals and our own individuals and personal memories. And when we do talk about it with each other, I think most of us feel at the time we really felt numb. We could not believe it. It just didn't seem real. We didn't want to believe it. But the idea that we can talk about it now I think, helps us heal at least a little bit. And I do think it's so important for the current skaters to get a chance to hear about each member of the team, because they need to know that how real it was. And you know, when I think of Maribel, immediately, she always has had things that each of us remembered. And I remember going to compete outdoors. And of course, she always competed outdoors and when she was at the beginning of her career. And I remember thinking, what if it snows and we can't see our tracings and we can't see where we are? And she very clearly said, trust your body, lean in, your body will remember. And sure enough, in Worlds in Davos, it snowed. And I remember so clearly inner forward rocker, turning my head and thinking, where is my tracing? But then remembered, trust your body and lean the way Maribel said. So each of us, I think, has some memory, whether it was of her racing after her girls on the ice, shouting to them as she did, or what. But this is a very special event today to be able to talk to each other. And I'm in the trophy room at our Boston Skating Club in the midst of Maribel's trophies. I'm thinking of the trophies that might have been added if the tragedy didn't happen, because our team was so terrific. And we really did expect that they would bring home with them the evidence of their terrific, terrific skating. And each of them was so personal to it. I came across a picture of when I first met Laurence. She was about 2 feet high and had her snowsuit and her snow boots on. And she was out on the ice at the Cambridge Skating Club while Maribel was teaching. And there's so many memories. And I think as we each talk to each other, it will just prompt us to talk about more. So I've got to let somebody else get their words in too. And I will keep talking and talking together. I love it.
I would like to talk about Maribel and how she guided me to becoming a coach and for the success I had. I'm not going to talk about her technique of teaching skating or skating skills. I want to talk about the things she infused in me as a person. First of all, she taught me great discipline, you know, about being on time. Always showing up, never backing out, not saying, oh, I don't feel well today, going to the rink, showing up, always, never complaining about the ice, and consistency. She taught me to deliver the same message all the time, not to change my technique and think, oh, well, maybe this will work or this trick will work, but to stick with the basic consistency of what I believed in and what I thought would work. And it did work for me. The other thing is loyalty. She taught me to be very loyal to her group, to what she did for me, to the Skating Club of Worcester, which I represented and helped me financially in the summer. And she taught me to definitely how to write a thank you note, which I had never done in my life. And she taught me about loyalty. Also, respect is something that I remember so much. An example, when I was young and skated in a championship, I think maybe it was the New England's, and I skated very well. So I had all these fans and people coming up and telling me I was the greatest thing since sliced bread and going on and on and on. And then I would say, oh, but I left out the combination jump at the end. And oh, my spins weren't fast enough. And Maribel got very angry at me, afterwards separated me and took me aside and said, Frank, that was so ungracious of you. When somebody compliments you, say, thank you very much. That's all. Don't elaborate on it. Just a straight up thank you. And I never forget it. And then, you know, at world championships later with my skaters, when people would tell me how wonderful they were, I would just say, thank you very much. That lesson was learned from Maribel. You know, I agree with Tenley. It was very hard for me to talk about the memorial, I mean, not the memorial fund, but the crash. And for a very long time, I could not speak of it. It was so numbing. It was so sensational. It was so devastating that I didn't want to think about it. I just blocked it out of my mind. But it wasn't until years later when I was in bed and I started to cry because I could not get Linda Frattiani's left inside forward rocker back in the days of school figures to point down the long axis. No matter what I did, I couldn't fix it. And I couldn't call up Maribel and I couldn't say, what am I doing wrong? She was dead and it was gonna stay that way. And I would never be able to call her again. That's when the real sadness set in for me. One thing that really bothers me is that I have no pictures of myself with Maribel, except one very poor picture that was taken at a show I did in Worcester, and she was up there. Probably Laurence was in the show too, I don't know. But it's not a good picture, but it's the only one. And I, at the time, didn't think, oh, it's not necessary to have pictures taken with Bradley and Gregory and little Maribel and with Dudley. I mean, I'll see them, they'll always be there. And so I don't have these pictures. And the other thing is, I never felt the need to say anything, you know, tremendously emotional or moving. So I never said, I love you.
Frank, that was a interesting point that you brought up about having photos of Maribel. And I know Christy Allen Piper, she had a similar frustration with trying to actually get a photo of Maribel. Christy, do you want to quickly talk about your frustration and trying to get Maribel to stand still long enough to get a photo of her?
Well, at the time of the crash, I think each one of us, as Tenley has said, and Frank, we were all so stunned. Words failed, and even skating failed, so we couldn't go to the rink for a while. So I decided I'd try to draw her and get them back. And so I did a drawing of little Maribel and it looked right. It got her gentleness. And then I did Laurence and I got her mischief and her twinkle in her eye. And then I did Maribel and it never looked right. So I never showed the drawing to anybody except my immediate family. And I realized when I tried to look for photographs of Maribel that everything that was taken of her when she was standing still or a portrait that was painted of her didn't look right. And I finally realized that the reason was that she herself, if she was awake, she was not still. She was like this picture. She was always moving. She never stopped. If she sat down, it was only to lace her skates or to drive a car. And she would always be multitasking. And I remember a lesson that I had because we would drive to wherever she was able to get ice. And we never knew for certain until the night before. And so I had the last lesson of the day on the outdoor ice at Milton Academy. And the snow was beginning to fall and darkness was beginning to come. And she hadn't had time for lunch. And so she had her sandwich, it was about 4. And she demonstrated a camel and she stepped into it, holding the sandwich and talking, narrating the spin. And then she did a plie camel so that she could reach down and point out where on her skate her weight was primarily placed, and then she rose and completed the camel, beautiful camel, nice upright spin, exited. And by that time, the sandwich was gone. And I realized she was always multitasking. She would talk and explain and demonstrate and have her lunch. I always called it in-flight refueling. But I think what we learned from her wasn't so much technique, but will and determination and discipline. And we all knew that the most important thing was to give our education priority, even over skating. And I can always hear her saying, point your foot, and my God, girl, get your hip in.
So moving on, maybe posing the question to the entire group, figure skating can often be seen as a solo or duo sport, depending on your discipline. But when you do travel together to a world championship or to an international competition, you do have a semblance of team spirit with US figure skating or, you know, whatever country you represent. Can anybody speak to the team atmosphere within these legendary competitors?
Jimmy, it's great to be with everyone this afternoon. It's our extended family for decades. It's terrific to gather on this occasion and think about our friends whom we lost in 1961. I think in 1961, there were eight of us from the skating club that went to the national championships competing in Colorado Springs. And we were very fortunate with some stunning performances by most everyone that we came home with the Harder Trophy, which is in the picture that's before you. We did feel very much like a team, both on and off the ice. We had several members of the skating club that are not in this picture, but I thought it might be appropriate because we had an extended family. Greg Kelly and his sister, Natalie, were also there. Eddie Lemaire and his son, Richard, they were on the plane crash as well. Of course, Bradley, Lawrence, Maribel Jr., Maribel Sr., and Walter Powell and Dudley Richards. So we had a big family. There's a group of us in this picture too. And I think it was fair to say that among the coaches, Maribel was the general manager. She was the one that cared about everybody, whether she was coaching them or not. In fact, I was reading a piece that she wrote, in fact, the last thing she wrote about the national championship. She, as many know, was the first woman sports writer at the New York Times. She was a very, very talented woman. But she wrote about Tina Noyes, who's on this call with us today. Tina was sixth in compulsory figures, but very, very close in the championship. And Maribel went on to say, mind you, she didn't coach Tina. Tina had two very, very good placements in figures and was very close, much closer than people thought. In fact, in a position to capitalize on her free skating, much more than people realize, her superb free skating. And of course, Tina went on to win National Novice that year and helped us bring home the Harder Trophy. We did a lot of other things together, of course. We not only skated, but I taught Laurence to drive. Not very well, but I gave it. We went to events off the ice. One day Maribel said to me, tomorrow night you're gonna go see Marcel Marceau. And I said, Maribel, what are we doing going to see Marcel Marceau? She said, well, I want you and Laurence and your sister to see someone who performs superbly without saying a word, because that's what you do on the ice as well. So we really did feel part of a team. In fact, many of the people on this call to this day feel part of my team. And I'm very pleased as well, because I'm still involved with the Memorial Fund, to say that we've been able to support a lot of other skaters over the years. I'll talk in a moment a bit more about the Memorial Fund, but it's a great privilege to be with you all this afternoon.
Oh, thank you so much. That was a great memory of that team and the impact that they also had to future skaters. As the 1961 junior champ, Lorraine Hanlon Commoner, you were invited to the post world championship exhibition, and you even had a flight for Sabina, flight 548. As a writer, I know you probably express your feelings best in the written word, and I know you have something prepared for us today if you'd like to share.
All right, I'm going to read selections from Walking with Birds, which was inspired by an owl walk with a vet who learned to control his PTSD through birding. And this appeared in Boulevard and Best American Essays of 2020. As we walked along, rather than discussing the war, he told me about his own difficulties. Even as I was flattered by his openness and his willingness to confide, a sense of malaise crept over me, a slightly off-balanced feeling that I hadn't experienced recently but recognized. Snippets from that post-Valentine's morning of almost 60 years ago were coming back. The lingering acrid smell from my fiery nightmare, mother standing over my bed, shaking uncontrollably, gripping my shoulders and screaming, "They're dead, they're all dead," and not knowing at first what she was talking about. Remembering my school's last minute ultimatum, go with the world figure skating team and don't come back here. The previous afternoon in my room with my coveted ticket for Sabina's flight 548 to Brussels, continuing on to Prague. The tearful decision to stay behind hours before the flight departed. Sitting up in a stupor as she shook me awake and asking, "Who's dead?" And hearing all of them, Greg, Bradley, Maribel, Dudley, Laurence, the entire team gone, our flight. Mother stopping, gulping for air. It crashed in Brussels, the fireplace andirons tilting. The months following the Boston Globe's 5 a.m. phone call informing my father of my death, along with the rest of the U.S. figure skating team, are blurred, save for a few exceptions. That day at school, mother had forced me to go when no teacher had mentioned the lead story on the morning news, their ultimatum, or my unexpected presence. That afternoon in the empty rink with the eerie parallelogram of light in the middle of the ice, the funeral parlor-like scent of the white carnation wreath at the ice entrance, the catchy Sabina Airlines theme song that played continuously on the radio, the photo of the Belgian police looking on helplessly at the shattered fuselage with Laurence's picture on this cover of Sports Illustrated flapping underneath the sheared off wing. In the silence of my room, I reran scenes from our shared childhood. The Fridays following the afternoon practice at the Starro Drive racetrack, running across the top of the fence wiggly board, ice cream cones at Howard Johnson's in anticipation of the skating club's Friday night stinky fish or overcooked beef supper. The day after the hurricane at Nahant Beach, when undertow warnings were posted and Laurence had disobeyed mother, going swimming before disappearing into the waves. The helicopter hovering 3 feet over the water's surface, the Coast Guard amphibious duck dragging for her body, mother about to pass out. A barefooted Laurence limping down the beach road hours later, mother breaking down in tears and pummeling her. Laurence, ribbons in hand, climbing the bleachers the next day to apologize and to ask mother if she would redo her French braids. The Nationals 10 days ago, our last picture together, a photo that has remained in my office, all of us unaware that we were already on countdown to February 15. The closest I came to the crash experience was the morning the bodies of Greg and Natalie Kelly arrived home. I had stood in their living room, a mute Mrs. Kelly some feet away, my hand on Greg's casket, wondering if they had dressed him in his blue blazer with the national championship gold blades on the lapel, like the one he wore when he took me to the Christmas dance. For a moment, I saw him standing by the boards, a gardenia corsage in one hand, in the other a gift wrap box, inside a silver four-leaf clover charm with our engraved initials, before the image was engulfed in flames. As I ran my fingers over the smooth walnut, I considered the possibility that there was nothing left to dress in that box and my legs turned to cement. How they moved me from the living room back to our car, I don't know. Some months after the crash, my mother took me to a doctor complaining I lacked energy. A little iron should fix her right up, he said, not asking about recent events or even about my sleep habits. At the time, reading disaster novels like Ethan Frome and The Bridge of San Luis Rey until 2:30 in the morning. Repeatedly, I would be heading down the hill on Ethan's sled toward the big pine or swaying precipitously above the chasm on the San Luis Rey Bridge, only to end up in the Boeing 707, tucking my head between my knees as directed as we spiraled down toward the chicory field. As the years passed, I would wonder if I had received more than I was entitled to. Athletic recognition, a place in America's top universities. A day doesn't go by without my being visited by a friend from the 1961 US World Team, or by Eddie Sholden, the Viennese coach who had brought me so far the summer before the crash. Never again would I fly as I had flown under his tutelage. With Eddie gone, I gradually lost confidence in landing. Sometimes I'd felt so right in the air only to have my foot slip away as it hit the ice. Perhaps it had been that way for the captain of flight 548 who at 900 feet, just 3 miles short of the runway, had pulled up the landing gear and accelerated into three sequential 360 degree circles at a steadily increasing angle before pitching up and then spiraling into a nosedive. No answers as to why, only a suspicion of stabilizer malfunction. How long did that attempted correction take? A minute or two? Did the lights go out? Was cabin pressure lost? Was it quiet save for the rush of air, or did they scream as they hurtled toward the earth? My airtime has always been a blur. And this is from the last section, after the vet is showing me the hummingbirds. You should see the male's courtship dive. The Navajo say it's a way for them to check out what is above the blue of the sky. In their mating ritual, the male soars to 130 feet before diving towards the ground at 88 feet per second. The force of gravity put on the bird's body by such a stunt purportedly resembles the near loss of consciousness in a fighter pilot performing a high-speed bank turn, perhaps something like what the passengers experienced in the final moments of Flight 548. But the Hummer never crashes, because when the male reaches the level of the female's perch, he arcs back up again. Thank you.
Thank you so much for being so vulnerable with us and sharing that essay that I'm sure evokes a lot of similar emotions from a lot of our Legends panel. I think it's very important as we reflect on that 1961 team, for those that might not have had that same, you know, experience with them. So thank you so much for sharing. I want to touch on what you touched on at the end of that essay, which is that correction, which is that comeback. And I think somebody who has such a unique story on coming back after the 1961 tragedy is Barbara Rolls Williams. She was asked to come back to competition after the tragedy. Barbara, do you want to share some of that experience with everyone?
I would love to. I don't think most people know that Laurence and I knew each other since we were 8 and 10 years old when her mother taught in Berkeley, California. We competed against each other as young kids and got to be good friends. And my coach and Maribel were good friends from the show days. So the four of us had wonderful time at competitions and we were young. We didn't medal, but we had a good time because we both loved skating. And I just thought that I would let people know that I've known her since way before her later competitive times. Also, I wanted to mention that my home club at the time was Arctic Blades. And there were members of the club on the plane. The team leader was Dean McMinn, who was a wonderful mentor to me, to my mother, and to my coach. And I named my son after him. Also, the wonderful, wonderful skater, Rhody Michelson, who was a fearless, not only a fearless competitor, a fearless skater on a daily basis. That girl just went 100 miles an hour like a horse out of a starting gate. And I really had a hard time. I kept thinking she would be home every year. She's coming back. It was very difficult for me to realize that all these people were really gone. I was asked by US Figure Skating if I would come back and compete to try to make the top five ladies in worlds, which was the ruling then, in order to have three people in the world competition the following year. So I, of course, I said yes without hesitation. And I owed it, the least I owed to all these people who gave their lives. So I had 5.5 very hard months of training after having giving birth to my daughter. And I went ahead and traveled to Boston for the national competition, in which I was greeted by Mary Goldblatt, who took care of my baby while I was there and helped with all the amenities. And I could never be thankful enough. And I had all the practices, everything went well. The morning of the figure event, the time was changed from 9 a.m. to 8 a.m. And I arrived at 8, being an hour, I thought an hour early. And there were three girls on the ice warming up. They hadn't started the event yet. And I said, nobody told me that they were changing the times. And they said it was posted on the bulletin board. We went and looked with some officials, and it was underneath a lot of other paperwork. So they said, we're real happy to let you go ahead and compete. You can do the first figure last and the second figure first, which was fine with me. I had a lot of resiliency. Nothing bothered me. I was lucky, and I guess I was born that way. And I won the figures, I won the freestyle, and won the event overall, which also helped a dream come true that I had, because I had won the novice ladies and the junior ladies, and now I won the senior ladies. So I won all three events, and I held that esteemed situation for 45 years until Kimmy Meisner won her senior lady title. So I was very proud of that. I went back home and trained for Prague. And when I arrived in the rink the first day in Prague, I was so exhilarated because there were so many people, skaters and officials, who were full of smiles and hugs and said how happy they were to see me. And it just gave me a really terrific feeling of belonging there and doing the best I could for the US Figure Skating Association, the team, and try to go ahead and qualify three ladies. And I skated well, I qualified three ladies. And at the end of the competition, the host association gave me a special trophy out of crystal that they had made for me for attending the competition, which I still have. And it was really very special. And every time I look at it, it brings tears to my eyes, because I know that all those people were planning to be in Prague and hoping to be able to skate in that arena.
Well, it sounds like you were an amazing leader and really the catalyst for the next, you know, couple of decades as the U.S. figure skating and the figure skating community at large was trying to rebuild. And, you know, perhaps Tina Noyes, the 64-68 Olympic team member, contributed to that sentiment as well. Tina, what was your experience knowing just a couple of years prior this, you know, happened, and, you know, competing with those people in mind?
Jimmy, thank you very much for hosting this. It's very difficult for me, and just hearing everyone's stories, because we all grew up together. 60 years, it doesn't even seem possible. But I was very fortunate, being 12 years old, on my first national championship, and being a part of a team. As a figure skater, individual sport, I never had that sense of being on a team, but yet we all trained together and we spent a lot of time together on and off the ice. When I was training at the skating club, I was always watching. I had such good fortune to be skating with people like Dick Button, Tenley Albright, Bradley Lord, and everybody on that, Maribel Vinson, Maribel Jr. And they were my role models. They were the people that I looked up to. I was watching how they were training, and sometimes things would happen. And Maribel was always good to point those things out. For example, I skated in that Ice Cycles show with Frank Carroll and Barbara and Lawrence. And Maribel was in the locker room. And in fact, Frank, you might be able to get some photos with you and Maribel and Lawrence from the Worcester Ice Cycles program. However, so I was in the locker room and Lawrence was so tired. She had just skated I Want a Dance program. And oh my God, she was so fantastic. And people were lined up outside the locker room wanting to get her autograph. She was like, I just can't. I'm just so tired. I just can't. Just tell them to go away. Well, Maribel turned around and said in front of everybody, don't you ever turn down when someone wants your autograph, because there might be a day someday where people don't ask. Well, we all went, uh-oh. And that was a lesson learned. And I wasn't involved with that, but boy, I heard it loud and clear. I had the good fortune, as Paul had mentioned, about being the coming up from my miserable sixth place spot in school figures, which, as Ronna knew, were not my favorite. And I skated so hard to come in first to just do the best I could. And my coach, Mr. Wilson, told me, oh, you have enough points. You have enough points. We're going to win the Harnett Trophy. And so I was able to stand in the middle of the group and they let me hold the trophy. And I was like, oh, this is great. And afterwards, Sports Illustrated came over and they were doing a big piece on Maribel and Lawrence and Maribel Jr. and Dudley Richards. And they were going to be featured on an SI magazine article. And Lawrence said, would you like to be in the article with me? I was like, oh my God, can I? She was like, sure. Why don't you come out? And so she let me jump on her back and let me ride piggyback. And I know she had a bad back, but she let me ride piggyback all around and they took pictures and they put that in the sports magazine. I was so excited because I was part of a team and she made me feel so special. Unfortunately, these days, 2 weeks passing, bad news came in and parents had received the phone call from Mrs. Kelly, who was very good friends with my mother. And she called that morning and I was getting ready to go to school. And she said, they're gone. They're all gone. And I couldn't believe it. And then I didn't want to go to school, but my mother made me go to school. And then no one at school talked about it. I don't know if my mother had called the nuns at school and told them not to discuss it with me, but it was good to keep some kind of semblance of normalcy, even though everything around me was not normal anymore. A month passed, and then the Skating Club of Boston was the first club to develop the memorial fund. And Paul will explain more when he tells you about the memorial fund, but I wanted to impress upon everyone how important it is. Everyone that's on this call had a part in the memorial fund. We were asked to do an exhibition, and then after it was at the old Boston Garden. And then after we skated, we were asked to go up into the stands and with a tin can, I think it's actually a coffee can, and they gave us pins and they gave us badges. And we were going to be selling them like booster badges in the stands to help raise money for the Memorial Fund. This was the beginning of what today is an outstanding legacy that has helped so many skaters. And I'm proud that I was a part of that first show. And I think that the Memorial Fund will always stand as having begun at the Skating Club of Boston. And I hope the young skaters listening today can understand what we all did to help pave their road for their future. And so that's how I feel about that. And Paul, I hope you can explain it better than I did. It's still very raw and very difficult.
For 60 years, I've called Tina Albright. That's our little inside name, but you did a wonderful job of talking about the Memorial Fund.
Thank you, Paul.
Also think everyone here has brought up another point, something that Scott Hamilton is fond of saying: we're in a sport where you take a lot of falls, but you have to learn to get up and get going. And don't you think that team in 1961, all those that we lost, would really want us to go on, to get up and get going? And I think you, Tina, were a great example. Lorraine, another great example of getting up and getting going. The lesson is to keep moving.
Thank you, Tina and Paul. That's such a great sentiment for skaters of the past and, you know, skaters of the future as well, as you mentioned, Tina. Rana, I want to ask you really quickly, as a staff coach with responsible for teaching the next generation of skaters, and I see you there all the time, always with a smile on your face, what do you try to instill in your students now that the 1961 World Team has influenced you?
Well, I am very blessed. This is Maribel's diamond ring, so she's always in my heart. I love teaching, and Maribel loved teaching. And as you all know, you guys, I was her favorite because I was the youngest, and I had to be very responsible. You know, Frank, I was very responsible and very disciplined. Maribel taught me not only to skate, she gave me education, and she taught me to live and to love. She and my mom were very close, and that's Mary Goldblatt, who helped Barbara when she was at Nationals here. And my mom and Maribel were really close. And being so young when Maribel passed, I feel that my job was to carry on as well as I could teaching. I love teaching, you know that, Jimmy. I love teaching with you. It's my passion, and it was Maribel's passion. And she taught us everything. I was having a figure lesson one day, and she said to me, "Rana, you have to stand up like the Rock of Gibraltar." I was probably 12, and I was like, "Okay." And she said, "Do you know what the Rock of Gibraltar is?" And I said, "No." And she went out and bought me a geography book and made me write a report on it. And these are the lessons she taught me, and I'm trying to teach my students the same, and I hope I am. She was my life then. She was my second mom, and I love her to this day. And Frank, I do have a picture of you and Maribel, and I'm blessed to have tons of pictures of Maribel and myself.
Great.
We'll have to have a photo sharing event, yes, after the panel. Rana, thank you so much. And thank you really to all the Legends panelists. The great thoughts that you have of the 1960 World Team, it really does inspire many generations. So thank you so much for sharing all of your memories of them. And I'm really excited to hear from our Team USA panel as well about what they feel they've been impacted from that team as well. But before, to commemorate the 1961 World Team in another art form, I would love to introduce Ellie Crowley Gardner. She's an award-winning author of the experimental poetry collection Trauma Head, about her experience with vertebral artery dissection and stroke. She also authored Serpentine Loop, a book of poems about ice, edges, and emotional freezing. She's the editor of the anthologies V6A, Writing from Vancouver's Downtown East Side, and Against Death, 35 Essays on Living. She's originally from Boston. She learned creative language from her mother, Tenley, who is also on the call, at the Scanning Club of Boston. And she now lives in Vancouver, where she's the director of Vancouver Manuscript Intensive. Ellie, thank you so much for joining us. And I'm so excited to hear your poem, Final Flight.
Thank you for having me. And thank you to everyone who shared their words and their memories. And here is a poem, Final Flight. The stairs of the plane are their final stadium at Idlewild, 1961. In this black and white terminus, skaters are dressed to conquer, arranged in a Valentine's Day send-off. The click of the camera begins the clock, 8 hours left. Sabina, flight 548, New York to Prague, one stopover scheduled in Brussels. Intimacy laces some passengers, athletes and their parents, officials, coaches, judges. 34 of the 72 know how to change it, how a change of edge ruins a jump. They know what they need to win. They are at the top, cresting on years of knowledge, accustomed to medals. They can tell the difference between a clean landing and a two-footed cheat. Unguarded faces, gleaming eyes, laughter ringing at the flash. Lumen cut into the future. How to register loss, the repositories they would have become. Each name is a world caught in a photo, fixed to a date by accident, a cruel lepidopterist. Considering names, pulling them up, is dangerous work. Figures I never met are filaments twined into my mother's becoming. Cousin relatives in a distant neighborhood, accessed by dream, by passport of memory, unstamped by crisis. One mustn't speak ill of the dead, or I suspect at all of the absent. What veneer could resist the etching of circles? Retrace, repeat. Each time someone requests a quote on the anniversary, grief is a scribe, lengthening the pain rib by rib. Before I am done looking, she puts the photo away. You always believe they will come back. It's just the trip is taking too long. I count off 32 of my own teachers and companions, enclose them in a fictional room, delete the room, see what happens. Names aboard not bold-faced, a teen wife, a priest, a businessman, 11 of a Belgian crew. Hit by spinning debris, Teo, killed while tending his field, endive, chicory, Marcel, a witness who survived but lost a leg. Hours after impact, the calls come in waves across time zones, words unanchored from meaning. They're gone, all of them gone. It is not a matter of thinking straight. It is that the dial spins. Each hour delivers another name. My grandfather drives to Mrs. Vinson in Winchester with his doctor's bag of sedatives to deliver the news, her entire family. Those who deferred a birth because of a broken ankle, an ultimatum from school, or who blamed a tenth of an ordinal for keeping them home, pick through newspaper lists, searching for details of who they will become, the spaces they must fill. Daily funeral services. Grief is a water wheel. Worn and grooved with pain, she no longer answers the phone. Skaters return to the rink, a sudden cathedral. This is their ritual, prayer of movement. In the days that follow the crash, passersby shiver at the sight of her, suspect they have brushed a ghost. 50 years later, she explains the guilt of living, sending her proxy to the funerals. She cannot explain what it feels like to have empty hands before the families of her friends and mentors. Loss is not dulled by decades, is as sharp and bright now as their smiles at takeoff. Another photograph captures the field outside Brussels 8 hours after. The wreckage, a holy disorder. Perhaps it was an engine, a mechanical fault, a gust of wind, or pilot error. An answer is sighing in that Belgian field, its ruinous connection, a linen trail of smoke. Memory lifts a veil of ash from the glint of metal. Only the blades remain.
Elliot, that was beautiful perspective. Thank you so much for sharing. Yes.
Sorry, I just wanted to say one thing that's great. Maribel's mom would never get on a plane. Any competition she went to, she took a train. And it was so just ironic that all three perished like that. My mom went with Dr. Albright to tell Grammy. And Grammy from then on used to come to the rink and watch me skate. I love them all with all my heart. And it just, this thing, it just breaks my heart that this had to happen. But I guess life goes on, and Barbara, my best friend forever, I love you dearly.
Kisses.
Kisses.
Well, I'm so happy that everyone was able to get onto Zoom as a panel to share these experiences with, you know, everybody watching, and to really commemorate it all together. And I think it's an amazing thing that these lives can be remembered with every donation to the Memorial Fund, with every skater that receives help from the Memorial Fund, which helps future skaters succeed and to live their dreams, just like the 61 World Team. I thank you everyone for sharing your experiences. With that, I would love to introduce Paul George again to explain a bit more in detail about the Memorial Fund and what it does for skaters.
Jimmy, thank you very much. It's been wonderful.
It's again, 5 o'clock.
All my longtime friends. I've often described February 15, 1961 as the day the music stopped. But it didn't stop for long. By March of 1961, several members of the skating club, together with Ritter Shumway and Carl Graham, got together and created the Memorial Fund as a tribute to the team. We have some records. I was able to go back and find one of the very, very early brochures about the Memorial Fund. And it says in part, the underlying thought of establishing the fund was to make a much more befitting memory and in keeping with the character and spirit of the members of the ill-fated team, to create a living and continuing memorial that would be of assistance to future aspiring skaters rather than to erect memorials out of marble in their memory. And I think over the last 60 years, that's exactly what's happened. It's been a living memorial to the team that was lost in 1961. I saw in early records that in early 1973, it had $135,000 in it. Now, thanks to the charity of countless fans and friends and others in the sport, it has several million dollars in the Olympic, along with the Olympic monies in the U.S. Figure Skating Foundation. The U.S. Figure Skating Foundation manages the money, and I'm pleased to say that over the past 60 years has given, again, literally millions of dollars to help support young skaters, not only in their ice training, but also in their education. I would say that what you've heard today about the coaches, all the coaches at the skating club, not only Maribel, Vinson, Owen, but Bud Wilson and Cecilia College, all cared about not only our skating, but our education. And I think this fund has done a wonderful job in enabling many, many people to gain an education as well as gain proficiency in the sport. I was amused as we go through, of course, I've known most everyone on this call for a long, long time. Tina was talking about being the favorite of Maribel. I always thought Frank was the favorite and wished I could be. We all, I think, with Maribel, when we were with her, got her undivided attention. She was the GM. She was a cross between Bella Caroli and Bill Belichick when it came to coaching. But she had at the heart of it all, and I would say that of Cecilia and Bud too, they cared about us. They cared greatly about us. And the Memorial Fund is a reflection of that too. The skating club had a big part in establishing the fund, and it's gone on now for 60 years, and it will continue in perpetuity. So thank you all who have contributed to it. Please continue to contribute. We have a lot of skaters that are aspiring to achieve great things. We can use all the help we can get. Thank you very much.
Well, that was a tragic moment, 1961, in February, and my father was the president of the Broadmoor Skating Club, and he got the first call, and it was, I sat up in bed and I thought, oh my gosh, what has just happened? But obviously a tremendous tragedy. The tragedy was that the entire United States figure skating team, there wasn't an official, there wasn't a para skater, single skater, dancer left, and we had eight people from the Broadmoor who perished in that flight. It's something of that devastation you never truly can ever get over. It's so because the people around you meant so much to you. You skated with them daily, and your coach had such an impact on your life. So it forever will be stressful for me to talk about this.
The Memorial Fund means so much to me. It gave me the opportunity to skate and continue skating, and truly has allowed me to become the skater that I am today. Without the Memorial Fund, it would be so difficult for many, many skaters to have the opportunity to train at different rinks, to train with different coaches, to train with different choreographers, all things that are very integral to becoming an elite skater.
It means everything to us because in the past, it's been the only reason we were able to afford to go to nationals and compete. So it's huge for the skaters, especially the skaters that are coming up. It does a lot for them financially.
I think figure skating is such a unique sport where, from an audience perspective, you see a couple or a skater go out on the ice and you feel invested and you feel like you're with them, or you feel like you can kind of share in their journey, and it makes us feel validated and special, and it makes us feel like we're not just skating for ourselves, you know, we're skating for other people.
It allows us to train at the level that we need to be on the world stage, to create our craft, and we just want to say a huge thank you to you. We love all of you.
In life, you know, sometimes the most amazing disasters bring forth the most wonderful things, and the Memorial Fund was a result of that horrible crash. And because of that, so many kids have had so much good things happen to them. So it's full circle.
Video shares a lot of the same conclusions that our panelists have brought up, that full circle moment. And you heard from a lot of current skaters from today. And we're so lucky to be joined from some current figure skaters at the US, at the Skating Club of Austin as well. And I'd love to introduce our Team USA panel right now. We have Marissa Castelli and Simon Shnapir, the 2014 Olympic team bronze medalists. We've got Audrey Liu, Misha Mitrofanov, 2021 US pairs pewter medalists. We've got Max Naumov, 2020 US junior champion, Alexei Krasnajan, US and international competitor, as well as Hannah Harrell, the 2019 US pewter medalist. Welcome guys, and thanks for joining us. I'm so excited you guys were able to join in. Let me first start off with hearing the stories of the Legends panel and watching the video of the impact of the Memorial Fund. What's your guys' reaction and how has it impacted your careers?
Well, I think I will start hearing the story again. The first time I heard the story was a long time ago, and then I had an opportunity a couple of days ago to walk through the trophy room, and it was so empowering and sad and devastating to hear about such a horrible tragedy. And then hearing this story again from all of the people that were involved, and I just think it was just truly empowering to hear this story and really to see how everyone shared their heart. But also it just shows how strong skating connections can be and how we create an extended family with other skaters and coaches. And I'm grateful to be here, and I'm grateful to hear about this story, and I'm grateful to be the part of the Skating Club of Boston and to look at the trophy room and just remember the history of skating.
Audrey and Misha, I think you guys were also touring the trophy room. How was seeing the history of the skating club, especially, you know, moving here recently and kind of learning about more of that history?
I just think it was like so surreal, you know, having so many amazing role models to look up to, knowing like all the goals you have are achievable, and that just looking around the trophy room, you know, you set an example, they set an example for our generation, and we want to set an example for the future generation to come. And the Memorial Fund has benefited us, helping us move to Boston and be a part of the Skating Club of Boston, training at the amazing facility, being able to train at an Olympic size rink every day, having more ice time. It's just, we are so grateful for the Memorial Fund and the Skating Club of Boston.
Yeah, it was truly incredible. Can you mute yourself? Yeah, it was truly incredible. Alex, mute yourself. Okay. No, it was truly incredible. Sorry about that. It was truly incredible because Alex and Jimmy and I, we're all roommates. It was truly incredible just to see all those trophies in the room, just to see what, turn your phone down, how all the accomplishments that we had of all the incredible people that came before us. And it just gives us, you know, it gives us that inspiration, that drive to continue to be able to, you know, do the same things that they were able to do. And it's just, it is truly inspirational.
Absolutely. Max Naumov, congrats on some great performances at the US Championship. What is it like following the footsteps of the 1961 world team and training at the Skating Club of Boston as well?
Yeah, no, absolutely. I think, you know, I also was there at the tour of the trophy room, and, you know, you never
know, you think like, you know, you're in the sport, and you, you know, you come in and do, you know, what you have to do every single day. But you don't always, you know, even realize how many people came before you, and, you know, just even looking at literally all of the actual trophies, that's so much work, that's so much effort put in by all these people that came before us. And, you know, because of those people, others were inspired and others wanted to start coaching and training and passing on just knowledge. You know, and that's what has, you know, that's always been from the beginning to even now, you know, and just being a part of something that is so, so big, you know, like years and years and years of just talent and excellence in the sport, and just even having my name be mentioned in the same, you know, kind of group or thing, like things like that is really is an honor. And, you know, yeah, the Memorial Fund is huge for so many skaters, including myself. I mean, you know, it's done so much for me and, you know, Skating Club of Boston in general, just giving us all of the opportunities to and resources to be able to, you know, get to wherever that we can. And, you know, it really means a lot. And I'm truly blessed to be training here and able to reach my goals for sure.
Thanks, Max. Hannah, I know, you know, competing and training and sometimes, you know, hard work and hearing about all of the stories of the Legends panel, what kind of inspiration can you take with you on the next, you know, couple training days or a couple training years?
Well, after hearing about the devastating tragedy today, it really made me like think about how close I've become with a lot of like students and everything. And even though this sport is an individual sport, it is a team because we all travel together, spend time together, we train with each other every single day, and it like motivates us and pushes us to become the best athlete we can possibly be. And hearing about everyone talking about like everything today has truly inspired me to become the better role model for everyone and being the absolute best athlete I can possibly be. And hearing about the Memorial Fund and how the Memorial Fund was founded and everything is also truly inspiring. And also I would be really thankful for the Memorial Fund, and without that, I'm pretty sure it'd be way more difficult to train. And also being a part of the Skating Club of Boston has truly benefited me in so many ways. And being able to train in such a great environment with the great like arena and the ice and everything is just truly like, I'm so grateful for everything. And it's inspiring to hear about all the people, like everyone that was like competing in the past and how they all we're working and everything, like it's just amazing in my opinion.
Thanks, Hannah. That's so great to hear that the 61 world team is affecting skaters even competing at the US Championships, you know, even just a couple of weeks ago. So thanks for sharing. Marissa and Simon, you both are, you know, getting started and kind of well into the coaching career, and even from your experience at the Olympics, how has the 61 world team affected your outlook on your competitive career? And can you take any of that and give that to the next generation of your students?
Hi, everyone. Simon, I wish Simon and I were sitting together so we could do this together versus two screens. But I remember 2011 was the 50 year, am I correct? Of the plane crash, and we did Ice Chips performance, and we did a memorial, and we also had the documentary Rise come through, and we, Simon and I, were honored to be part of the documentary. We were some of the silhouettes. Oh yay, hi Simon. We were some of the silhouettes in the Rise documentary, and I think from that moment moving forward, it was such a eye opener of what they did for the club and how much they meant to everyone. And for Simon and I'm going to speak for Simon here. Every day, every day in 2012, the summer leading up to our first national championship, I would look up every day and see Maribel and Dudley's name on the national pairs champion. And I was like, I want to get there. I want to continue their legacy as a national pair champion. And that really inspired Simon and I to continue the excellency of the Skating Club Boston and just their excellency moving forward. And we're so honored to have our names next to their names now forever.
Yeah, and you know, having listened to some of the legends that have spoken today already, it really, for me, two words really stand out, honor and respect. Respect, obviously, for these legends, past and present, you know, who paved the way for us to continue the great traditions of the skating club through the memorial funds. And that's helped to honor their legacy. And, you know, Marissa and I, as young coaches who have transitioned into coaching, you know, we're incredibly blessed to learn the important tenets of coaching from, you know, greats like Rana and Frank. And many others, and to share that connection with them, with legends like Maribel, who unfortunately we never met, but hearing these wonderful stories, it's to be able to just share a little bit of that connection is really inspiring for us as we transition into our coaching careers.
Absolutely. Amazing sentiment from, and maybe great for the Legends panel to also hear that the stories are still affecting and will continue to affect skaters of generations and generations to come, even, you know, past 2021. So thank you to all the Team USA panelists for sharing your reaction, your experience, because I think it is truly full circle, like Christy Krall was saying in the video. So with that, I'd love to introduce the executive director of the Skating Club of Boston to give some remarks and reflections on the Memorial Fund. Doug Zinkheid.
Thank you, Jimmy. And thank you to everyone on this panel today. Intimate and powerful stories with folks who knew everyone who perished, but also our skaters today. And Paul George, I think we need to follow up because there's an incredible oral history that can be done here. And I think become part of the archive, certainly of the club, but maybe of US figure skating as well. The other thing I'd like to say is, touch on something Frank Carroll, when he said, I could not speak of it, meaning the tragedy. And my family grew up at the club they joined, I think, in 1965. So I grew up at the club in the late 60s, definitely still in the shadow of the crash. And as a little kid, I knew something terrible and awful had happened, but nobody seemed to be speaking of it. And maybe it's because they just weren't speaking of it to a little kid, but my impression was it was there, it was a shadow, and it was so horrible, nobody could talk about it. And Frank, that one quote just brought me right back to being a little kid at the club and that being my impression of it. The other thing that struck me from this panel and the conversation and the crash and the lives cut short and the careers and the joy I always see in the photos from everybody on that team is, you know, it's an old saying, but just how fleeting time is and how tenuous our opportunities are when they're presented to us. And I think that ties into the Memorial Fund and our skaters today, because athletes only have a certain amount of time to do their thing, to be brilliant, and to make their mark on the sport. And it's frequently at a time when their resources are at the lowest and when something like the Memorial Fund is needed the most. And I think that's one of the most important things about it. It's there for our athletes when they need it the most. And having been around this sport for over 25 years as a professional, I know from all my interactions, and this is touching on a question I saw from one of our viewers, how appreciative the athletes are. I hear it firsthand. I see it in the volunteering and their interest to give back. They definitely appreciate it and feel the love and look to return that love. Tina, I want to thank you for reminding me and everyone that the Skating Club of Boston was there in a leadership role when the Memorial Fund was founded. And I think that's why we take that role seriously today. And if you don't know, the club for the past 2 weeks has had sort of its own fundraising campaign going so that on Monday, the anniversary of the crash, the 15th of February, when US figure skating has a full day of fundraising, our plan is to announce our fundraising to date that morning to encourage everyone around the country to also give. And we've raised in the past 2 weeks, just a little over $11,000. I think $11,500. And I encourage everyone to give, to be part of this for skaters around the country. And Tim just had a QR code up on the screen. You can snap a photo of it. You can also go to scboston.org or go directly to US Figure Skating to the Memorial Fund donate page there. And hopefully, you know, what we've heard today will move you to become part of this. And thank you again to everybody.
Thanks so much, Doug. Super important. I think if anyone does have that chance, please do visit those links and please do donate. Because as you've heard from our skaters and the skaters of the past, the Memorial Fund does make a difference. So thank you for reminding us. I do want to make sure that everybody knows and everybody watching knows that tonight's panel discussion is being recorded. So if you'd like to relive it or review something that you want to take another look at, please do look for that link and we can get that out to everybody after this.
And to live on the scboston.org website, do you know?
I know that it will be sent out and we can absolutely link it there.
All right, great.
For sure. Absolutely. And so with that, I'd love to give the Legends panel, those that are left, Tenley, Frank, Paul, Lorraine, Barbara, Tina, Christy, or Rana, any final thoughts as we close out today's panel discussion?
I do think that Mrs. Vinson was really had a tremendous effect when she kept showing up at the Friday night suppers at the club, and she stayed in the community, and she inspired the skaters, even though she'd been through what she'd been through.
Tenley, I think that's exactly right. I found her membership in US Figure Skating, her membership card, just the other day, and I gave it to the club for the trophy room. She stayed a member of US Figure Skating, showed up at events, and until her death in, I think, 1967 or 68.
And remember, she was a suffragette.
And this trophy room has all of Maribel's trophies right in it, right behind me, and some of Lawrence and Maribel Jr. But think we would have had more of those here if it hadn't been for that crash.
Well, Tenley, we have a lot of yours right behind you too. Wonderful trophies that you earned.
And also, Paul, imagine if that team had a chance to train at this facility.
Oh,
the spirit is here. Yeah.
This is a spectacular facility. The new Skating Club of Boston is first among equals.
Tenley? I would like to tell Tenley that I was at your parade in Newton right after you won the Olympics.
Oh my goodness.
And I brought you flowers.
Yes, yes, yes.
It was so wonderful.
They had made a skate for me to sit on top of.
Yes, it was wonderful.
Rana, you make a great point, because I think one of the things about skating in our time, and I hope in the current time, being around skaters like Tenley, Dick Button, Hayes Jenkins when he was at Harvard Law School, and many others, really inspired us. It was wonderful to have the talented skaters to look up to.
Absolutely. It was our inspiration. We were very blessed for that.
And I remember Eddie Lemaire skating he with his big jumps. And Diana is still a member of the club.
Yes.
May I ask a question?
Sure.
When we skated, now that dates us, and wasn't it required that we had to have an educational certificate in order to
Yes, that's right.
Everybody had to go to school. Everybody had to have an education. And Maribel wanted to know what kind of grades you were getting. And
I had to show her my report card from Manta Hall, Tenley.
And this is why the academic center at the skating club is so important now.
Yes.
I remember, Frank, driving to Worcester, to that rink you and I trained in Worcester, with Maribel. We didn't talk about salchows and axles. We talked about antonyms, synonyms, in preparation for the SATs. About all that stuff.
Paul, do you remember her station wagon that was growing mushrooms in the back?
Yes.
And my dad had to buy her a new station wagon to drive us to all the different rinks.
Why? Because he was afraid you were going to have a crash?
Yes.
They had to tie one of the doors on.
Yes.
You know, Frank, Michelle and Laurence had so many parallels. Do you remember Laurence failed her driving test the first time?
Yes.
Maribel asked me after that failure go out and teach her to drive. I took her out, tried to teach her to drive. She came back in a second time. I said, how did it go, Laurent? She said, not well. I backed into a hydrant.
Oh, God.
At least Maribel didn't teach her. Maribel drove her car with her skates and skate guards on.
Exactly.
At 75 miles an hour, uproot 128. 70 miles an hour.
Frank, I remember driving in a snowstorm to Worcester because Maribel found ice. And my father thought we were crazy. He said, are you crazy? Maribel said, absolutely not.
Great memories.
And to understand, Barbara, how much fun it was to skate at the Skating Club of Boston in the 60s.
Yeah.
It wasn't just about the baseband.
Well, I had a great time skating the chips, and Maribel threw me a birthday party when I was there with all the skaters in her house. I mean, it was packed with skaters and food and Grammy and everybody. It was so much fun. It was so thoughtful of her to do that.
She
was so busy. I know she loved me and I loved her too. Don't make me cry.
Let us not forget her Christmas parties when we would have to decorate her Christmas tree.
Yes, and when the tree would fall over on Grammy, and we would have to drag Grammy out by her ankles with the tree on top of her.
I know.
Well, I remember.
Granny was a suffragette. She had an incredible spunk.
And she drove. She was not a very good driver either.
When she would drive down a one-way street the wrong way, and we would scream at her, no, she'd say, stop it, children, they'll see me coming.
Oh my goodness.
I remember
there was so many good times.
Christy, did you have a story that you were going to share?
On Christmas Eve, Maribel used to take her daughters and some of her daughters' friends, who were all her students, to go to Beacon Hill,
Carroll,
look at the Christmas lights and listen to the Christmas carols. And then we would go back to the farmhouse in Worcester, and there in the dining room, the floor, the shelves were full of the trophies. I think there were more trophies there than are at the skating club now.
I have a couple, I think.
Well, I'm sure. I just remember that it was almost wall-to-wall trophies, and the buffet was filled, and then the overflow was on the floor. And so then Maribel leaned across the dining room table, to light the candelabra. And as she leaned forward, she extended her free leg. And Lynn Finnegan, I think she was national junior champion at the time, when she said, "See how she even points her foot when she's lighting the candles." And Maribel said, "Well, of course, that's how you keep your balance."
Frank, do you remember Flossie?
Oh God, yes, yes. She hated me. She hated me.
She did not.
She did. I took too long in the bathroom.
I know, we had a time limit. I told the kids upstairs when I was showing them the trophy room that I had 3 minutes to change my boots from my patch to freestyle.
I just want to jump in and say it's so heartwarming to hear the stories and
the funny stories,
great times. It sounds like amazing friendships that can be formed through figure skating and the skating club and U.S. figure skating as a whole. And so I do want to extend, you know, deep gratitude to the Legends panel for joining us today. You guys have been such an amazing role models, and the stories that you brought were so great to hear. So thank you all for joining us.
Thank you, Jim.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
I'll
send you that picture.
Okay.
I have a couple more people to thank before everybody logs off. I do want to thank our awesome audience for sticking with us and hearing all of these awesome stories. The crew behind the scenes, they've been doing a lot of work, switching cameras, making videos and things like that. U.S. Figure Skating for contributing immensely and helping us with this project. The Skating Club of Boston for lending technical support for organizing and lending some rooms as well for people who needed that. The Team USA panelists as well, thank you so much for being here. And to close things off, I do want to thank the 1961 World Figure Skating Team for their contribution to the figure skating world. Thank you all so much for joining us, and hopefully we can all see each other in the rink soon.
See you soon.
Thank you.
Bye, Bob. Love you.
Bye.
Bye, Frank.
Bye, dear.